Hello and welcome to the special telecast in the run-up to the big budget. We're calling it a tryst with destiny. Expectations are running sky high. Indeed, this edition of budget debate, we're going to put the spotlight on the market, what the market expects from this budget. There are some controversial tax proposals that could have a significant impact on the market. Is there a case for some of those proposals? What can the government do as far as the market is concerned is what we're going to discuss with some of the finest minds in the world of taxation and the market. I'm Sandeep Gurumurthi, and joining me in my news center in New Delhi is my colleague Supriya Shrinate.
It's a great evening to be with you, and we're joined by a very power-packed panel: Ketan, Dalal of PwC, Bobby Parikh of BMR and Associates, and Nilesh, Shah of Kota KMC. Join us right here on ET Now. Thanks very much, gentlemen, for being with us. Markets are scared that there could be something untoward coming in the budget. The question that we're putting to all of you is there a case and is there a reason for the markets to be spooked? But let's take this across to Nilesh Shah. And Nilesh, I think the Prime Minister just a few weeks back did make a case for markets contributing to national growth, and he did perhaps lay the ground for a certain tax to come from the markets. Of course, there was panic. The Finance Minister then came out in the open. Clarifications were issued. But the larger question is there a case for taxing the markets?
I think instead of taxing the market, the way, you know, one commonly understands is like, let's tax long-term capital gain, let's increase short-term capital gain tax. I don't think so that's the right way to tax the market. There are far better ways to tax the market. One of them is a loophole called bonus stripping. In the market, people buy cum bonus shares and then sell X bonus and take short-term capital loss. Now, this is absolutely unnecessary privilege given in the market. This can be removed in this budget if government is listening to us. There is something called tax planning through illiquid shares, Z group shares, small enterprises shares. Now, clearly there it is visible that people are taking advantage of illiquidity of stock market to create long-term capital gain, which are tax exempt. Clearly, this kind of malpractices should be stopped. There is third avenue where people are converting interest income to long-term capital gain through zero coupon debenture. The law's spirit and intention should be to tax interest. It can't be allowed to be converted to long-term capital gain. I can keep on going on and on about all the privileges given to market in terms of taxation loopholes, in terms of shortcuts, in terms of smart practices. I think it is important for government to stop such shortcuts, such smart practices, such loopholes, and then you will collect far more from the market, which you are assuming otherwise you will collect by, let's say, taxing long-term capital gains tax.
Bobby, how did you read those comments from the Prime Minister coming just a month before the budget, when he said that that it's time that the financial markets contribute to nation building? You know, he gave it a whole nationalistic spin, and it's hard for anyone to argue against it. How did you interpret that comment? Obviously, the market interpreted it as a case for tweaking the long-term capital gains tax, and then the Finance Minister came and clarified. But how did you interpret that statement, and do you believe there's a case to get more tax? Look at the way our markets have grown over the last a decade or so, the way market cap of companies have grown. Do you believe fundamentally there is a case for the financial markets to contribute more in terms of taxes? We'll come to the manner later, but do you believe there is a case?
See, I think that, we have a, I think the biggest issue that I see with the taxation and financial markets as a particular aspect that we are focusing on, is that as with most other policies, there is a need for some level of stability in what the policies are. And I think markets tend to get spooked not so much by what the tax is, as much by any uncertainty that exists or gets introduced into the taxation framework from time to time. And, we did an analysis of the number of times that the capital gains tax provisions in the income tax law have been changed since the time that FIIs were allowed to invest in 1992. And I think between 1992 and 2016, if my memory serves me right, I think we've had some 16 or 17 changes in the capital gains tax provisions. So this is something which becomes, far more troubling than whether, the right level of tax is being applied on capital market participants and whether they should contribute more to the tax kitty. There are many views whether capital gains exemption that we have on long-term capital gains is something that should be continued, whether that's appropriate. Most other countries seem to tax it. And, you know, we can debate the merits of that, and I don't think that there is any clear policy that or a clear pattern that emerges across countries when you look at them. But I would sort of submit that the bigger issue is that, you know, if we have to consider our context, we have to consider what is necessary for us. There is a clear need for capital, there is a clear need to attract investments into the market, and if this is something that helps to do that, then my view would be that, you know, we don't disturb it, we ensure that it remains stable, and we work to facilitate flows into the market as best as we can.
Mm-hmm. Ketan, comment on that. Do you believe fundamentally what we need right now, stability, and in a sense, anything that would upset that stability could be very disruptive for our market? So even though there may be a case to get more money out of financial markets, it's best not to disturb, at least in this budget?
Yeah, I think so. I'll tell you, while I agree with Nilesh in terms of, you know, plugging the malpractices, just let's step back and look at the bigger picture. You know, financial investments in financial assets is 2% of household savings. I was very surprised, Sandeep, to read that in India, only 18 million people invest in equity, which is 1.5% or thereabouts, and as compared to, let's say, 10% in China. So China would be comparable. I'm not comparing with a developed country like US. Mm-hmm. So if you step back, this is one issue. Today, we are again buffeted by a whole set of global uncertainties, and domestic uncertainties. One of the top industrialists of this country said, we live in a VUCA world, but today, you can't see more VUCA than this. We are in a very volatile environment. So I think today the situation is better. And remember, now we have GAAR coming in. We have Singapore and Mauritius treaties having been amended. So we are living with a whole host of other uncertainties. In this context, while there is a case to tax capital markets, and you talked about how we have grown over the last decade or so, I think this is not perhaps the time to touch it. Maybe a year later, let's see how the economy grows, is perhaps what the way I would look at it. And I think the long-term capital gain exemption, I think, should stay, for example. And the possibility of, let's say, increasing of that period from, say, 1 year to 2 years also perhaps could be kept back in abeyance for the time being is the way I would put it.
Sure.
All right. So as things stand, I think the three of you at least concur on one thing, that why fix what ain't broke right now, and why do this in a rush as things are? Let sentiment be repaired and then perhaps look at it later. But Nilesh, let me ask you a more candid question. Do equity investors deserve a more privileged treatment than their cousins in the debt market? I'm not even talking about investors in other asset classes. But, you know, between equity and debt, there is so much of privilege that equity investors have. Yes, India is not such a well-developed market. You need those kind of things to attract that investment. But is that privilege warranted even now?
I think it is necessary. It is not that equity market investors are not paying tax. They are paying tax through STT. It is also important to note why were domestic local investors were given this privilege, because foreigners were given a far better privilege. They were not paying short-term capital gain tax, they were not paying long-term capital gains tax, and that's why the ownership of Indian equity was moving in the hands of foreigner. By giving a level playing field vis-a-vis foreigners, we have enticed domestic investors into the equity market. Last 4 months, FIIs have been selling lock, stock and barrel. They have taken out $11 billion from debt and equity market put together in last quarter. And yet markets haven't felt the tremors of this mass exodus because domestic investors are participating. So let's value domestic investors' contribution, which has come probably because of tax incentivization. But it is coming to make them at par with foreign institutional investors. And even today, compared to local investors, FIIs do get a preferential treatment in short-term capital gains tax. And more importantly, we are retaining economic ownership of India with Indians.
Right. Bobby, just let me throw the other question that's out in the public domain as a part of public discourse. Some people in finance ministry are beginning to talk about this. Well, maybe not reintroduce LTCG, but perhaps look at tweaking the time period for the long-term capital gains, which may not be 1 year, but maybe 3 years. Do you think that could be counterproductive as well?
I think so. It's not. It's unlikely to be 3 years because they've reduced the. So if you see how things have moved, 2 years back they increased the period of holding for unlisted equity shares to qualify as long term from 1 year to 3 years. Last year they brought it down from 3 years to 2 years, and therefore my sense has been that this was a precursor to also raising the period of holding for listed equity shares to qualify as long term assets from 12 months to 24 months. So that's just my hunch. I don't know whether that will happen or not, but I just sort of see the movement of what's happened with the unlisted shares, and I'm extrapolating, and I think that that's what's going to happen to listed shares as well. Should it be 12 months? Should it be 24 months? I don't have a particularly strong view, other than my sort of general comment that I just expressed, that I believe that there is greater value in leaving things the way they are rather than disturbing them if there is not a very significant implication that is likely to arise. I don't know what we gain out of that. I don't know what the economic modeling would suggest if you were to increase from 12 to 24. Is that likely to produce materially greater tax collections at the short term end? Do we have data to be able to establish that? I actually don't know. The amount of capital gains tax foregone a few years old data was not substantial, and when you sort of match that with what was collected in STT, the gap that remained was not huge. And I think that relative to the merits of keeping stability and something that works well versus trying to capture a small gain, I would very clearly weigh in favor of stability. And, you know, as Ketan was also alluding, I think that, and the point that Nilesh made as well, you know, we've removed pretty much the capital gains exemption under the Mauritius Treaty, we've removed the capital gains exemption under the Singapore Treaty. So the non-resident investors and potentially the benefits that they might have got from investing through favorable treaty jurisdictions is no longer going to be available on a going forward basis. And we've just leveled the field between the non-resident investors and the domestic investors. Do we want to particularly now introduce more change? We are living in enormous flux, and I think there is much to say for stability.
Sure. Nilesh, this is a point that both Ketan and Bobby made, and you spoke about it as well. If you were to move it from 12 to 24 months, seems like you're being fair, and the sort of indication was that that's what they were moving towards. What's the downside, you know, in terms of, you know, this whole equity culture that we're trying to bring about? You know, Ketan made this point about how we're under-penetrated as far as equity investment is concerned, and the stated objective of the government has been to push, channelize more savings into the financial market. But if you were to just tweak it from 12 to 24 months, sentimentally, other than the near-term impact that, you know, near-term knock that we might see in the market, from a long-term investor point of view, won't you encourage people to stay invested in the market for at least 2 years? You know, all people who register SIPs, and you, for one, preach that, and so do we in the channel, that the best way to invest is stay long-term. So what changes if it moves from 12 months to 24 months?
Sandeep, as you correctly mentioned, near-term impact, who knows what it will be. But in the longer term, I don't think so there will be any material impact. We have moved on the debt mutual fund from 1 year to 3 years. There were fear that it might result into outflow from debt mutual funds, but that has been proven unfounded. We have seen investors continuing and making adjustment to 3 year lock-in period in order to get tax advantage. I think over last 15, 20 years, mutual funds and, you know, media and regulators have worked together to create this financial knowledge among investors that equity is a longer term product. And if you move from 12 to 24 months, I don't think so, other than short term sentimental impact, it will have any material negative impact.
24 or 36, whatever it may be, there is a case for STT to be abolished. In fact, be difficult. You're at least being more realistic than some of your other counterparts from the markets. But we've had a discussion on this, and I think some of it to the Mauritius and Cyprus and the Singapore treaty being tightened. Ketan, you mentioned this early on, so let me bring this on to you. How does this change things? 2 years, over 2 years, they will end up paying the same short-term tax rate of 15%. Do you see fund flow from there weakened? That's point number one. And point number two is, given the fact that the treaty has already been tightened, does that give government the elbow room to not touch LTCG or not to do anything experimental at this stage?
I think, Supriya, what is happening is that it is possibly incorrect to think that a very large proportion of FII inflows is coming in through Singapore or Mauritius. There, it is substantial, but it is not like 70% or 80% at all. A lot of it is coming directly from the country in which the FIIs are located. So, for example, USA. Having said that, Mauritius and Singapore definitely have given a tax benefit, and the tightening of that treaty, and just for the benefit of the viewers and just to make sure that we have it in perspective, the provision now is that any investments made before 31st March 2017 is grandfathered, in the sense that whenever it is sold, it will continue to be exempt. So if you have bought something today and if you sell it even 6 months later, 9 months later, 2 years later, it continues to be exempt under the provisions of the treaty. However, if you buy something from 1st April, okay, so let's say you buy on 1st April and sell in October, then under the India-Mauritius treaty, you would earlier have been exempt, but now you will not be. And by the way, if you remember, the provision for the tax between 2017 and 2019 is 50%. So it will not be 15% if you are investing through Mauritius or Singapore, but it will be 7.5%. One point I do want to make is FIIs are concerned, because our clients are talking to us. FIIs are concerned that it should not happen that the 50% tax rate, which is 7.5 as I explained, is again impacted by general anti-avoidance rule, or GAR as we call it. Because as you know, in most of the cases in Mauritius, the tax residency certificate is the basis on which the claim is made. So I think from a stability perspective, and again this is alluding to the point that Bobby made, it is important for the government to come upfront and clarify that the 50% will be available to Mauritius based FIIs for the period between 2017 and 19. That's the point I would like to make. But as to whether it will impact future flows, I think again Nilesh is better equipped to deal with that, and I think that's much more of a question of economic opportunity both in India and other comparable countries and the emerging market allocation. I'm not a markets person, so I can't say that, but certainly tax is an important thing, and I think what really spooks them is uncertainty. They just want clarity, because then they can build their economic model and the potential returns based on a law which they know exists, as opposed to getting something, you know, suddenly emerging out of nowhere.
Oh yes, sir. Certainty is what the market wants. The other issue, of course, the point that we also spoke about briefly was on tax on FPIs and the triple taxation, that the controversial circular that's now been put on abeyance. But Bobby, what do you expect in terms of clarification in the budget? Because this isn't the last we've heard on this issue, and that overhang is still there as far as equity markets are concerned. What's the clarification that you think the government should come up with in this budget?
So I think this is my point really, and I've met, and we've sort of experienced many such situations over the last, even if we just look at FPIs and what's happened with them over the last 2-3 years. First we had the controversy on MAT that happened a year and a half back. Then we went through an extended period during which the government and the ministry sort of insisted that this tax is levyable. If they have to pay tax, they must pay tax. Then they realize that maybe this is not the right way to look at it. Then some clarification is issued, further clarification is issued. Eventually, the budget is the Income Tax Act was amended to exclude FIIs from MAT. Now we have this indirect transfer, which is a law which is there from 2012. So if it had to apply, then it should have applied from 2012, and it was retrospectively applicable. So therefore, it was applicable forever. We are in 2017, and a circular gets issued today which suggests that, well, you know, if investors came in and out of the fund overseas, then you should be liable to tax, and you know, all Indian tax provisions will apply to that. I think that these are the kinds of things which fundamentally shake confidence, and we've had 2-3 of these kinds of incidents just over the last 18 months. And then, you know, I'm just sort of connecting to our earlier conversation on capital gains and whether it should be taxable, whether the duration should be changed. We've changed treaties, we will introduce GAR. I mean, we are living in an uncertain world, and there is no need for us to engineer all of that uncertainty into our tax framework as well, all at the same time, although we seem to be doing that. So I think that as far as, if we sort of go back to the principles of what this indirect transfer was supposed to and intended to do, it was really seeking to tax income which the government believed was Indian sourced income, but tax on that income was being avoided because the transfer of assets was taking place at an overseas level, and that transaction itself was otherwise not liable to tax in India, and therefore what was really Indian source income was escaping tax. And if we sort of keep that principle objective in mind, then you have to really look at entities and how they are operating. And if an FII which is investing in India, if it is going to pay tax on all its income that it earns in India, then there is no income that it will earn that is going to escape Indian tax. So do you really want to extend the provisions of indirect transfer to a level beyond the FII and extend it to the investors themselves? And is that really what was contemplated when this indirect transfer amendment was made to the income tax law? Mm-hmm. And I think we sort of lose the perspective on this in terms of why this was introduced in the first instance and what was it seeking to address. And instead of that, we sort of mechanically then take a 2012 amendment and then apply it to a given set of facts and say that, well, if I look at this law and if I look at your facts, then you are liable to tax. But that doesn't consider the objectives, and that is troubling. And therefore, I think that the amendment should be that if there is income which is accrued to a non-resident investor and if that income is liable to tax in India,
right,
then investors sitting on top ought not to be then subject to tax, because the income that India wants to tax is exigible to tax. And so long as that is clear, then why do we need tax at any levels which go beyond that?
Fair enough. Nilesh, let me get closing comments from a panelist running out of time. Nilesh, very quickly, what do you attribute these sort of, you know, flip-flops to? And we've seen it with repeated governments. One expected better from this government. Is it just a lack of understanding of how financial markets and foreign investors perform? What do you attribute to, you know, and sort of Bobby started this answer by speaking about a series of issues where there's been flip-flop by the tax department. And probably the political leadership of the country doesn't even take many of these decisions. And they're probably unaware. I'm sure the FAQ that was put out by the CBDT may not have been, you know, vetted by the finance minister for all you know. So what do you attribute this to?
I mean, it's very difficult to understand irrationality. I mean, how do you predict irrationality? My guess is that the best answer is that we still believe from 1947 syndrome. We still think foreigners have come here to rule, and which is why some segment of government continues to come out with rules and regulations which are not really in the line of spirit which India should be.
Ketan, you agree that there is a disconnect as far as taxation is concerned between the top political leadership and what this last mile tax guy really does on the ground, and his actions have a repercussion and they go on to actually make or break sentiment. The leadership on the top may actually want it otherwise.
You know, what Nilesh said is very correct. You know, sometimes, see, what is happening is the feeling in the government has been generally that business and, you know, foreigners have come here to loot, and the cross-border investment, of course, is unfortunately one of the first, you know, sort of targets of that. So long as we do not have that mindset, or if we can change that mindset, I think things will be better. So, and the one way to sort of bring that out to the government, and many of us have tried that, is to say, look, when an Indian company goes abroad, what happens? I mean, it's obviously there to make a profit. It is certainly not going there to make a loss. And while laws should be fair and favorable, and maybe there should be some kind of a level playing field, if we need more incentive, and Mauritius was a classic example, we had to incentivize because our foreign exchange position was bad. So that's one point. The second point is that, you know, Bobby spoke about MAT on FIIs. You know, I think the problem is we forget the original intent. MAT was clearly, if you see, intended to apply to domestic companies which were claiming depreciation and tax holiday benefits. But when years go by, somebody starts looking at you know, every comma and full stop. And when you try and interpret a provision without keeping in mind the original intent, you have the kind of situation. Exactly the same thing has happened in indirect transfer. If we step back and look at the bigger picture, what was the situation? A foreign company investing in India through an intermediate company, obviously with a substantial stake in the Indian company, and then the Indian company is somehow sold and you don't pay tax. How now, when you look at it from an FII perspective and somebody has a 6% stake in an offshore fund which invests in India, how would he even think? Just think of the converse situation of an institution in India investing, let's say, 5.5% of let's say a Franklin US Opportunities Fund in India, which invests in US, would he ever think that he would have to pay tax in the US? I don't think so. So I think there is a disconnect because practically what happens on the ground is sometimes forgotten and the original intent is also forgotten. I think these are the two, both the issues are, I think, equally important.
All right, on that note, completely out of time here, the big takeaways is why fix what ain't broke? Profit isn't the bad word, and more importantly, why add to uncertainty when the world we live in is as it is so full of it. But Nilesh Shah, Bobby Parikh and Ketan Dalal, we really appreciate you taking time out and joining us this evening on the Big Budget Debate. Thanks for watching. Keep it with ET now.